the next stats. And we would like to pose you one question. Then you choose how you contribute to the place, of course, but we can summarize. One of the main topics is the question of the legal labor market status and the fact that in our project we reject the hybrid idea of a third status, okay? So this is one of the main points that we arrive to demonstrate. And the second one is the rethinking of social protection within a frame with three dimensions. One is more universalistic or more selective way. And the other one is voluntary and mandatory, so it's dualistic dimension. Another one is public and private. And so the second one is the rethinking of social protection within this dualism. And the third and the more important dimension is the emergence of emergence and recognition of new actors. And the enrichment, future enrichment of the social dialogue, and also in relation to the dialogue between traditional and non-traditional users. And we attribute in the last presentation of Manuela, you can come here if there is a chair. It's useful that you react to yes, we have used in the last slides a strong and powerful role of the new players in this context as a choice, because really the scenario is very dynamic and very rich of new experiences. So we are talking about what is next, how the new scenario with new actors and players can contribute really to support the needs to support the self-employer and the self-employed professional. So, if you want to add something, or we...
No, we'll not add anything, so I propose that we just begin with the first question,
yes,
so one by one. So the idea that we come to the conclusion at the end of this project that at least the question of the hybrid status of the third status is not a good solution. So we can explore other solutions when considering the legal status of workers. It can be just the enforcement of the existing regulation on workers. It can be a redefinition of the status of workers, or it can be a redefinition of the status of employer. So we have different options. What are, in your opinion, the best solutions to explore in order to face the challenges that have been highlighted during this and this day? Who wants to take the floor? Yeah.
So
Irene,
from the ILO. So from my perspective, I think you would share the cautious view that you have towards creating a hybrid status. I think from the ILO perspective, we would be looking more at, we have actually, maybe just briefly, in order for people to be able to follow, briefly just say what the ILO is, because I don't assume that everybody is aware of how we function. So we have, the core business of the ILO is essentially standard setting. So our members, which are 187 governments, whose workers and employers organizations, they come together at the ILO and they negotiate international treaties. And these treaties and ILO jargon are called conventions. So once a country ratifies a convention, it obliges itself to bring its law in line with that convention, and it's also obliged to report to the ILO how the convention is applied. there's also an independent committee, an independent from the IWO committee that is looking at the authority to decide whether or not the country is actually compliant with it. And there's also a different type of international agreement that is negotiated. It's like a convention, it's just not binding, it's called recommendation. And there has been a recommendation on how you can determine, for instance, the employment relationship. And it's recommendation 198, so it has been a year-long discussion for many years. And so from an IWO point of view, we would say it would be better to make use of that instrument to define the employment relationship. For instance, that the recommendation says that in order to determine whether or not there is an employment relationship, you should use the primacy of facts. So it means you don't listen to whether the person thinks he's employed or he's self-employed, but you look at the actual performance of work, and you look at it on the basis of a subordination. So it can be, you know, is that person really autonomous, or is he acting actually on a firm that's more akin to an employee? That's one point, and that's the point that is used by the European Court of Justice. But also, the recommendation includes the point of economic dependency. So is that worker actually dependent on one of the clients, and therefore that economic dependency would be considered more as an employee? And another helpful approach that this recommendation puts forward is the presumption of an employment relationship if one or more of these indicators are present. So, for instance, if there were a periodic payment of a fixed compensation akin to wages, that would be one indicator that indeed that is an employment relationship. Or the fact that working hours are determined by the firm, or indeed the economic dependency. So from an IWO point of view, we see that this recommendation is underutilized, also by the courts, and that would be a helpful approach to better kind of counter the misclassification of workers, so that are classified as self-employed, but are actually would be considered as employees.
Hello, my name is Katarina Jaksic. I come from DG Employment. I am here as a client, in a sense. And I would first of all like to congratulate Renata and the team for this very impressive work. I find it very interesting. I will also take 1 minute to say how it will fit into our work and make a bit of publicity for what we're doing in the LENTIC and the Commission and DG Employment, of course. But also for choosing this ideal place to have this conference. And I think it's quite a hot topic, considering the weather outside and the number of people we have in the room on the Friday afternoon. Exactly, so congratulations. Why is this important for us, this project in general? For two things. First, for the analytical purposes, we in DG Employment are currently preparing a report on uniforms of work. Imagine. It's a highly topical issue these days. And we, in this report, we are looking at similar issues you're looking at, in fact, from a political point of view. But our target group is a bit broader. We're not only looking at professional self-employed, but also other forms of employment and what is becoming more and more, let's say, topical, the platform work and what is happening to platforms. So when it comes to the status, we have the court's definition, we are using it in some of the initiatives that we put forward. I'm not a lawyer, so I have a difficulty replying to that question, but just conceptually, it becomes even more difficult, I guess, when we start talking about workers who perform small tasks. If you go to practical work, not necessarily Uber or Deliveroo or this kind of thing we do, that are often in the media, but also work that is done online, and we do small tasks. How do we approach that issue? So I think this is a very interesting debate. I'm hoping to hear some answers, because because we are also looking for policy recommendations, as you can imagine. That's why we push this kind of projects and so on. So I think it goes even a bit further, and this is going to become, in the coming years and decades, even more pertinent issue to address.
But you don't really answer the question about the so.
No, I don't. Intentionally.
Sorry?
The situation is regulated different in, differently in different countries, and I think you showed that very well. For us, as said, for you, there are two initiatives that we put forward recently. The access to social protection, but I guess that is more for the second question, and the written statement, the new written statement directive, where we apply different approaches for different reasons. But I guess Thiebaut will tell you more about that.
Okay. Hello, Thiebaut Weber from the European Trade Movement Federation. We don't think there is a need for a third stage. First, because as mentioned, we have all the legal tools that exist to possibly reclassify a worker, which is possibly misclassified. But even with that, it doesn't solve the entire problem. Because look at a really independent worker. For 2 months, he can work for one client only, that will define it. So in case you want to be reclassified, he could, if you go to sue the employer in a court. But in the practice, it's not always the case. So we see that there is a difference between the legal definition and the legal, what exists in terms of legislation, the right, the law, the legal law, and the practice. And this is where, this is in this gray zone, that people organize and find maybe through self-regulation, organization, mobilizing, the way they can organize their profession. And this is the way many professions, independent workers, in health sector, or in law, or others, organize or self-organize in many countries. So it gives us opportunities as movement, as trade unions, also to find solutions complementary to labor law, of course, that fits to the specific realities of one sector, and on the other hand, possibly also have legal action to reclassify workers who are wrongly classified as self-employed, in particular in the platform economy, where they could be genuine self-employed and freelancers, but on the other hand, where it is not true that, or we should not buy this narrative that is sold by platform economy big players that says platform economy equals self-employment. And behind that, there is the ideal vision of a world where everybody is self-employed. This is not true on the other hand. So that is really important. So this change, we should have a broader definition of workers. And I think that the example of the British law is interesting, because if you look at the reclassification case of the Uber drivers, they were not reclassified as employees of Uber, but as workers, which is a broader definition.
I'm sure that this is a hybrid status, isn't it?
It is not a hybrid status like a third status, for example, here in Belgium, you know? It is something that covers classical employees, but also defines a responsibility for employers, which are recognized as such. It's not necessarily, I don't see it as a third status, but we can debate on that. What I wanted to say is that the two initiatives put forward by the Commission on the written statement directive of this new fair working condition directive.
Transparent.
Fair working condition directive. Wow. And predictable. Okay. So everything is false. Sorry. No. And the social protection initiative, the recommendation, it missed a bit the target, which was indeed to broaden a bit the definition of the EU definition of a worker. And that's a bit a pity, because it talked about new forms of employer, of employees or workers, and in courts is already found right the platform workers as well. But the definition keeps fitting at the classical vision of employees and the classical link of subordination. So this is where, let's see what happens, what will happen in the parliament if they will bring some amendment that will extend a bit the definition of workers, but it brings new rights for classical workers, for sure. I mean, this is a good initiative, but on atypical workers, there are still progress to be made in the legislative process.
Good afternoon, everybody. I work for the World Employment Confederation, which is the global association representing temporary agency work companies, as well as recruitment companies, career management companies, you know, all the companies providing HR services. And of course, this is a topic very dear to my own mind and heart, because I've been writing a lot on this changing world about the future of work. And I think this is a very important topic that we've been discussing today. Many people are talking about the future of work. What will the future of work look like? And I think this discussion is part of this thinking. And actually, when you speak about the future of work, it's usually very good to go back to the past, because my belief is that the future of work will very much look like the past. And we are seeing that. And the rise of self-employment, actually, is something that is taking us back to the past, where before the first, you know, industrial revolution, most of the workers were self-employed workers. You know, they were craftsman people, they were small shopkeepers, they were working from home, they were their own boss, they were paid on piece, so it was about on-demand, you know, work and on-piece work. And it seems that, at least in our developed economies, we are going to this trend again, which is quite interesting. It doesn't mean we have to go back to the past and then forget everything from today, but I think it's interesting to keep this in mind. And the other characteristic, I think, of this changing world of work is this increasing triangulation of the work relationship, where in the past, you know, there was two parties involved, the worker and the company and the employer. Nowadays, more and more, you see a third party entering into the relationship. As I said, I represent also the agency work industry. Actually, you know, 50, 60 years ago, the temporary work agencies, they started to create this triangular relationship. And it created many problems. And there again, that's why it's good also to look at the past. And the first reaction of, you know, governments, trade unions, when agency work developed in Europe in the 1950s, 1960s, the first reaction was, ooh, we don't like that. This is triangular, this is temporary, this is disrupting the existing standard of work relationship, let's ban this form of work. And actually, that was the case in many countries, a clear ban on agency work. But then this industry came up, you know, saying, well, this is not possible, let's try to find solutions. We entered into dialogue with some unions in many countries, and we came up with a compromise with the unions and the government, saying, okay, we should be able to exist, there should be some conditions, there should be regulation and so on. And I think this is exactly the topic we are facing today with the self-employment. But at the same time, I think we already have some regulation in place. And then back to your question on whether there is a need for a third category of workers, yeah, from our side, we don't believe in that. For many reasons, and but one of the key reasons is the fact that nowadays we have already two very, you know, different forms of work, either you are a full employee or you are self-employed. But what we are seeing is that the border between the two is becoming increasingly blurred. You know, you have full employee workers that are actually very autonomous at work. Their boss are telling them, okay, I don't care how many, you know, hours you work a week or a day, the important is that you reach your objectives, and you can work from home, you can work from anywhere, as long as the objectives are being fulfilled, I'm happy. So in a way, they are, you know, employees without a big boss. On the other hand, we discussed that today, they have, you know, self-employed workers are actually not autonomous at work, they are depending on one customer, so they, in a way, they should be, you know, classified as a wage worker. If you create a third category of worker, it's not one border you will have that is blurry, it's two borders. So you are actually making things even more complicated. you know, whether you are in the category 1, 2 or 3. So indeed, and that was also said today, we live a labor market that is becoming more and more complex. If you are adding complexity to an already very complex labor market, this is not going to work. Huh? In the past, a very fashionable word was flexicurity. How to reconcile flexibility and security. I think the new world of today is simplexity. How do you simplify the complexity of today's labor market? I think this is what we have to try to achieve today. We saw there for the time.
Okay, so I think we achieved almost an agreement. I was hoping that it was a full agreement, but I was a little bit shocked when you used the reference to the UK situation. Because I think most of us are rejecting the idea of a third status or hybrid status because of many reasons, the existence of the employment situation and the necessity to refer to it in a series of situations, the complexity of the system, and so on. And considering the reference to the worker status in UK, it depends if we consider worker as a basis for any kind of work, whatever the status, and then defining a series of rights linked to that, or if we consider, like in UK, worker as a very specific situation between the employee and the self-employed situation with a limited set of rights, and in that way, I'm not sure that we our studies and our reflections support the idea that it could lead to a